Now, every year, we try to look back over the last few years and update some of the videos, our technical videos, with the latest information and possibly some of the things we've learned in the last year or two. We're going to dedicate this whole video, or DVD in some cases, into dealing with the little idiosyncrasies and information that we've learned about props in the last 52 years of modeling. Now, in the case of propellers, not only is the information that you need kind of elusive, but I'm not sure even if you wanted to go to an engineering school that the information you'd get that would concern real aircraft would apply to control line stunt. And what we're trying to cover in this tape is the information that'll be useful in tuning a control line stunt plane, tuning the props to match the engine output and the requirements of the airplane. Well, you might remember we've had quite a few videos in the past that dealt with this, and that information gets updated constantly, and we try to constantly put the latest information on the latest presentations. And one of the reasons props are so difficult to understand is you really don't have a way, other than if you get out to the field and you have a lot of time and a lot of propellers, to do a lot of testing. Without a lot of testing, it's hard to learn a lot. So what you hope is that somebody that has the time and energy to do the testing, and there are a few people beside myself that do this constantly, that they can pass it on to you and save you the time and the energy, and of course the money. Now, we're going to go way back to 1966 when I was flying a sweeper. And that was about the beginning of the time I became fascinated with props. And we're going to back up just a little more so you can see how this information evolved. Now, I even want to go so far as to cover, if we do have enough time and space, some of the really complex things, in this case, reverse turning props on twin engine planes. But if we don't have enough time and energy, what I'm going to try to concentrate on is information that will help most of the people most of the time. And I think I've been pretty successful at doing that in the past. I hope I'm going to be even more successful in the future. It's been a long journey learning this, and I really hope I can pass some of it on that will help you enjoy the sport of model aviation even more than you're enjoying it now, because I've enjoyed it my whole life through. Now, most of this presentation is going to be simply storyboards, little drawings that I think I found very useful in helping people understand the knowledge that I have, and certainly my knowledge is not the only or the dominant one, but it's certainly one of the ones I think you can use in combination with your own experiences to upgrade your information, and again, the whole objective is to get the most enjoyment out of the sport of model aviation that we have, that we all seem to share. And so for me, I'd like to start my story way back. Boy, I think this was 1961. This was a year that Harold Price shared a lot of his knowledge with me about finishing, among other things, but also about props. And back then, we were all using Fox 35s. And I think that's a good place to begin this discussion. Where it ends up will be how much time we have on the DVD and tape. And I'm going to try to cover as much as I possibly can and pack it in as simple a method as I possibly can, so the most people can understand it. And understand it. It's a complex subject. Sometimes it's difficult to boil it down, but I'm going to give it my best shot. For everybody that goes back, they're modeling back into the 50s, I think we all are subject to this. Remembering God, the good old days. Now, back in the good old days, anybody that goes back that far, and even some people that don't, remember the dominant motor at the time was the Fox 35, still in use by many nostalgia people. Still one of the classic motors, whether you like high-tech, low-tech, old, nostalgic. Fox 35 certainly has earned its place in the world of stunt. Now, if you remember right, way back when, you really only had a few choices. Wood props. Props were all made out of wood. Some nylon. Not many people use nylon, even though it was available. They were dangerous. They used to break. But from this, you would probably always have the following thing happen. Somebody would always tell you early on that if you had a Fox 35, you'd go get a wooden 10-6, and you'd start flying your Nobler, Smoothie, Thunderbird, Oriental, whatever. And the net result was, this was a very simple tuning choice. It was almost right all of the time. The reason it was always right, or most of the time it was right, is the Fox 35 had an incredibly wide range. It was able to be run a little bit rich, a little bit lean, be run with a muffler, without a muffler. It had a lot of good characteristics in its favor. It obviously had some bad things in its favor from time to time and batch to batch, but one of the things it did, it suited the needs of the stunt pilot for a lot of reasons. It was easy to figure out what prop to use. You'd almost always use, in some cases, people would use a 10-5, some people would use a 10-6, some people would try to use maybe an 11-6 cut. But the problem was, you basically always wound up with a wood prop, and you wound up with a very narrow range of choices. And what happened is, they almost always worked. You have to remember, or keep in mind, you had a relatively simple thing that had a very few simple choices, and people, through the trial and error, had narrowed it down for you. The engine was able to handle a wider range of things. And so what happened is, back in the 50s and the 60s, the choices that you had, this was an easy thing to figure out. Almost everybody, when you got to a relatively big contest or to the Nats or to the mirror meet, everybody kind of had this figured out ahead of time. And there wasn't the choices that you have nowadays. Also, making this even easier, is almost all planes had a relatively common set of numbers. They were all a rough size, shape, and flew on pretty much the same length lines. So what that made it even easier to get this all dialed in, and for a new person to come into the event, buy a Nobler kit, buy a Fox 35, get a wooden 10-6 prop, figure out how to get it to run, and then get two or three prop choices, get out to the field with one line length choice. What happened? Years ago, this was a lot easier than it is nowadays. Nowadays, we have a lot more choices, and that's what makes it a complex subject. So if we start way back when, good old days, and you start realizing why it was this way years ago and how it got to be the way it is now, then you start to realize all of the choices that we have nowadays are really upgrades. They're really good choices. And if those choices don't appeal to you, you're always able to go back to the old system. Problem is, when you go back to the old system, most people want modern day performance, higher performance, among other things. Modern engines offer a lot of advantages. But we don't want to just leave this out of the discussion and pretend like a person who doesn't remember his roots. These are the roots. This is where it all started. George Aldrich, Bob Palmer, Don Still, they all had this wired pretty well out. And among all the people that worked on that end of developing the world of control line stunt, this was an excellent, excellent thing. And then if you're flying nostalgia, it's probably still an excellent thing, even though you have more modern motors. These motors, the old Foxes and Fox 29s, they tend to have a little bit different sound, a more traditional sound, among other things, that would attract you to that part of our event. But we want to move on to the next level. Now, there are several levels in this, but we certainly, to make it simple, I want to start at this level. So we have this, and we can always go back to this little diagram. Now, and it depends. It's a very subjective thing to decide when this event started to change. A lot of people think it started to change with Lou McFarland's Shark 45. A lot of people think there's another key point, a watershed at which it changed. But you have what I call, this is the mid. The middle of, just to make it simple, the mid. In this range, what happened was, you had other engines, and we're just going to be, to name some of them, K&B 45, ST 46, ST 60, and possibly throw in some of the other engines, and I'm not really able to include all of them, but you basically had these, they were loop scavenged engines, that meaning they had a baffle on the top of the piston, loop scavenged engines that like to run in a mid-range. They were not high RPM engines. They ran in the mid-range of power. They like to run between 8,000 and 9,000. So what happened in this time? Prop technology changed. Within this group of engines, what happened was, now you had a choice of props that probably started at 11.6, 11.5.6, 11.5, the EW props that a lot of Tigers 46 is used, a lot of 12-inch props, a lot of 13-inch props if you consider the Tiger 60. Now what happens, you have a range, you had a lot more choices, a lot more testing to do to find the optimum prop for your setup. Now, what also I think happened, and this is a subjective thing, I think the performance of these bigger engines, first off, the planes got more impressive, they got bigger, I think they got easier to fly, they certainly impressed people more. There used to be an adage that big plane, big score, among other things. But what happened, as our event evolved, this got to be more choice-oriented. You had, and now you also had, around the middle or toward the end of this time, here's what really made it complex, is you started to see, and I don't know the exact year, it's not important, you also had the choices of wood props and carbon fiber, both of which had features and gains that were possible. But now what happened is you had, between the wood props, you had all these choices, and then in the same amount of choices in carbon. So you had more choices, and then you doubled it. So now, to get that optimum setup, or to be sure that you were at the optimum level, it just got to be a more complex equation. And so we're not going to belabor this, but I just want to make this point, because we're going to refer back to this from time to time. In that middle range, everything seemed to get more complex. Planes got bigger, a little bit more expensive, used more fuel, but the big thing that changed was the propellers got more sophisticated, and you also went from basically the Fox days of having only two-bladed props to threes and fours when you had carbon. So you had a lot more choices to deal with. Now, if you can kind of understand that that's the direction this event went in, then the next step seems to make a lot more sense than possibly it would have if you didn't realize the history of the event. And that's why I'm going on and on about this. Now, you can pretty much define the modern era any way you want. You can define it. A lot of people define it by, and it, I don't think it's a valid definition, but they define it as the time Bob Barron won the Nats with, in 1996, he won the Nats with a loop scavenged engine, a Tiger 60. And that was the last time a loop scavenged engine was really on the cutting edge. But I tend to think it turned around about 1990. And so it's up to you to think if it's 1996 or if it's 1990 or what your favorite engine is. And you can, this discussion could go on forever. But it definitely turned from to where Schnurly ported engines became the vogue thing. Now, it started with what we'll call VMAXs, Randy's engines, PA-40s,
which became PA-51s, which became PA-61s, which became PA-65s, which became PA, I think it's a 75. Okay, notice what's happening. If you look at this whole equation, the motors are getting bigger, the choices are getting more and more. At the same time that you're getting more choices for each engine, you're getting choices of carbon props. Some manufacturers make glass props. Some manufacturers still make wood props, and they still can be made to work. And you have the family of props, the APCs, the glass reinforced nylon. So, wow, when you go into this, and if you had a selection of props for each one of these engines, you'd have a lot of propellers at the end of it. But this is now how we define the modern era. The modern era, and this is where we're going to spend probably the bulk of the time, is in Schnurly-ported motors. Schnurly-ported motors, even when they're timed at stunt timing, they run at a higher RPM. And that can vary by motor. It can be as low as possibly 9,000, and maybe realistically going up to 11,000 for a VMAX. But notice what's happening. Schnurly-ported motors, higher RPM. As the RPM goes up and as the choices get more, prop choice becomes more and more critical. Now add into it the fact that you also have a lot of other manufacturers now. You have Rojet, first of all. Double Star. People making more and more choices available. So what happens, whether it's a VMAX, whether it's a PA, whether it's a Rojet, whether it's whatever your choice or your personal feeling, and let's not leave out the LA series of engines, the Maxes, it doesn't matter. What happens is you have choice after choice after choice. You just have hundreds and hundreds of choices of props. Very unlike the early days. And that's what makes the information, I think, on this video useful. So without going any further, we know now how this evolved into a thing that started out real simple, ultimately got very complex. We won't even count because I'm not going to have the time to do it. Is you've got to add into here four strokes. Several of the Europeans, and of course Paul Walker and myself with the Typhoon, we really made four strokes work, I think, as well as they can work, or maybe a little better. And you also have Mikey Palko, Walt Brownell, and Bob Hunt. You have guys developing electrics, and Will Moore, and there's probably even more people developing. So now this is going to become an issue. You still have the people in Europe with the four strokes, and with the real quiet two strokes, and with the loop scavenged motors, and with I don't even know what we should call them, the Discovery Retros that run at a low RPM with a real high compression. You got so many choices, it's staggering. But it doesn't matter. If you have a basic understanding of how to find your choice, I think you'll be way ahead of the game as to just buying 1,000 props and spending 2,000 years at the field. I just think you can benefit from this knowledge. And this is, I'm going to try to simplify this as much as I can. There's an adage that a really stupid person can make something simple sound very complex, and a really smart person can make something complex sound simple. So I'm trying to make it sound simple. Whether I succeed is really a very subjective thing, but I'm going to really try to get this information simplified almost to the point of being oversimplified. Because when I look back at some of my old videos on this subject, I realized some of the information was put forward very well. Some was, I didn't really finish the discussion. I want to finish the discussion. I guess the basic understanding that we all come to at some point in time, we need to know how a prop works. Whether you work for Boeing or whether you work for a boat propeller. A propeller works the same way a wing works. A wing and a prop are very similar. And I'm even going to make it even a little simpler than that, a helicopter blade. These three things, the way they work, the way a wing works, in its most basic form, air traveling under it, air traveling over the top, has to go a longer distance, so it becomes a low pressure. The air at lower pressure wants to pull a wing up, or the helicopter blade, or the prop. In the case of a helicopter, it's pulling the helicopter up. And by changing the pitch and the angle of attack, it makes the helicopter go in every direction. A prop on a typical stun ship, and of which you can figure out, the propeller is really creating in front of itself a low pressure zone. Now, some people think, and it's an incorrect assumption, they think that what's happening is it's blowing air back. It's pulling the plane. It's not pushing the plane. Now, by every definition that I've ever read about in books or from people like the people at Boeing that really do know this stuff, it's that low pressure area, the same as the helicopter. A helicopter is not blowing air toward the ground. It's pulling up. Same thing if you envision what's happening with a stunt ship, it's pulling it forward. So by figuring this out and by understanding what that low pressure is, and you can really look at this and say, well, okay, how would we make this better? Well, one of the ways of making it better is just making the physical disc a little bit bigger. You can picture what happens when you make a bigger physical disc. You have a lot more, and it doesn't go up in a linear way. It goes up in a way that if you add an eighth of an inch to the diameter, you've added probably about 10 or 12%. You've added it around the whole disc. So if you understand right in the beginning that you're going to get the force pulling forward, it's to your advantage in a lot of ways, but not all, to have the physical disc as big as possible. That's like having the biggest tire on a drag racing car, because it makes the biggest low pressure zone. Now, what are the limiting factors? The limiting factor is if you have a Fox 35, the prop will only maybe be at 10.5 or 11 inches. It'll never be 13. If you have a Tiger 60, it's probably going to peak out at 13. If you have a Rojet 77, it's going to peak out at 14 or 14 and a half. Every motor is going to be limited by how much diameter it can turn. And that the way I define that is prop load. Now, prop load comes from more than one thing, but understanding prop load and how it relates to physical disc is step one in figuring out how you can tune to make your setup better. The first thing is to realize you would like in all but a few cases, and I'll try to explain what they are, to have the biggest physical disc that engine will turn. You'd like it also not to overload the motor. If the prop is too big, the prop load is too much, and it's like trying to drive uphill in fourth gear when you're towing a boat. You'd always like the prop load and the physical disc. These are going to try to two things, they're like if you had $1,000, you can't have something that's $1,001. You've got to always have the amount that your motor will turn. Now, what is the test for a prop load? My test, certainly not the only test, is we have the plane sitting the way it normally would be. We'd set the needle just a little rich, just on the rich side to where it's almost in a two cycle. And then what I want to do is, while the plane is on the ground, I want to pick the nose up. And I want to hear the engine increase, and increase significantly in RPM. If what happens is, and I'll just make fake numbers up, if it's 9,000 here and I pick the nose up and it's 9,000, prop is too big. If it's 9,000, I pick the nose up 9,500, probably just about right. 400 or 500 RPM increase is about right. If I have the nose here at 9,000, I pick the nose up and it goes to 12,000, prop's too small. It sounds real cool, but it isn't going to give you that maximum physical disc that you're looking for. So what happens is, trying to gauge it, you can do a lot of it on the ground before you ever go to the field. You want to establish that stunt run, just a little rich sound. Pick the nose up, see it go into a dead two cycle, and see an increase in RPM. That's my test for the prop load. But what affects that? The biggest factor in it is the diameter. Nothing affects the prop load more than the diameter. When you go from, and we could make from a 12 inch to a 12 and a half, say, you've really increased the prop load quite a bit. And when you go to 13, see, as these numbers get bigger and out at the 14 plus range, what happens is these prop loads get astronomical. You really have to have the engine tuned right on its power peak. Diameter is the biggest thing, but it's not the only thing. It's the pitch. A lower pitch prop loads the motor less. Pretend you're in first gear in your car, you need a lot less horsepower to drive along in first gear. Put that car in overdrive, you need more power to keep it going. These are factors that increase the prop load. Not only the pitch, not only the diameter, the thickness. And this is where it starts getting tricky. If you have two props, and one is very thin, typically props are a 25% airfoil. If you have a thin prop, and now right next to it you have a prop that's real thick, let's say this is carbon and this is wood. This prop is going to load the motor a lot more. This is going to load it a lot less. In conjunction with that, and as part of that, if the leading and trailing edges are razor blades, think of an APC prop. When you make the leading and trailing edges very thin, it increases the efficiency, reduces the prop load. So there, within this range of things, you also have props like the APCs that come to razor blades at both ends. You also have under camber props, which tend to load the motor. They really load the motor, in fact. And an under cambered prop, and then we're going to talk about Phillips entry later as a way of changing a prop. But be aware, you have a lot of things that go into the prop load. Biggest is the diameter. Second probably is the pitch. Third is the thickness. And the fourth is a real important one. The aspect ratio. Now, if you ever forget this information, it's easy. A glider. You look at a glider. Here's a glider. Big, long, thin wings, long, thin tail. That's a glider. High aspect ratio. In other words, it's longer than it is wide. And an aspect ratio is measured by the mean average length by the mean average width. In other words, if this is 9 inches and this is 7 inches wide, the mean average is 8, then you multiply times the span. Now think about this for a minute. A glider is very efficient. But the problem is, a lot of times in the world of stunt, we don't want it to be that efficient. We want it to be like an automatic transmission. We don't want big bursts of power. So a lot of times you've got to decide what's going to make a setup more efficient. What's going to make it less efficient? A low aspect ratio where the blades are wide and fat is going to be very, very inefficient. Where that really works well, wide, let's just make a thing, because this is kind of basic 101. Well, this is a low aspect prop. This would be a high aspect prop. If you think of props, Doran's props, Gator props, very, very efficient, high aspect ratio. Have a real low motor load. A wide blade would be like a BYNO prop. Or a prop that you've cut the tips off to make a 13-inch prop a 12. This low aspect, this is going to load the motor a lot more than the same diameter in this. If everything else is equal, this is going to make the motor load a lot more. It's also going to give you different effects of loading and unloading in maneuvers. So what happens is a thick blade is going to give you a lot of gyro effect in the nose, maybe make your level flight a little bit better. This is going to increase the corner. So now you have trade-offs. Even when you're not dealing with the typical things, you've got other little things to deal with. But just remember the old glider thing. Long, narrow wings, long, narrow props, efficient. Low, relatively inefficient, higher motor load. Things that make it thick props, you need more horsepower, bigger displacement or more highly tuned engine. Thin prop and specifically under cambered props, very highly tuned engines. This might be the 101 of figuring out where this whole thing goes on your plane. But this is all information that try going to Harvard and taking a course in. It doesn't happen. You got to learn this. There are no courses in model aviation. You can learn it yourself out at the field. You can learn it from some of the other people, George Aldrich for one, Harold Price, Jim Greenaway, people that have gone before us, and we can pass it on. Or, in some cases, people learn things, they keep it a secret, and it dies with them. Now, back in the old Fox 35 days, we used to do this. We'd take a top flight prop that had this airfoil, and it was typically a 25% or something very similar airfoil. We knew it worked well, but what happened is we wanted the plane to go just a little bit faster. Well, if we want to go a little bit faster in terms of speed, one of the things we can do is increase the pitch. So what we can do, and I got to get a little tool to do this because it gets tricky. What you can do is sand the whole bottom of the blade if you're very, very careful. You can, and let's just make this our mean average. This is where we started from. This is the pitch line. And what happens is we want to have to go just a little bit faster. We can just pick the nose of that pitch up ever so slightly so that this material is removed. Well, now what we've done is we've increased the pitch angle. We've gone from low gear to second gear. There's a certain amount you can do this with wood props based on how thick they are. You probably even could go at some point in time. You can go a little bit further and sand the whole bottom off and go a half a pitch number. A 5 could become a 5.5. And this is typically what you do with wood props to change the pitch. That's one way of doing it. There's also the way that we call, for lack of a better word, and I've heard people that really do know this stuff say the right word is Phillips entry, and I've heard people say, oh no, it's some other word. But a Phillips entry is when you hear that word, here is what it is. You have the pitch that the prop starts at, and I've got to use a ruler to make this accurate. We start at that, that's the angle of attack. Here's our blade section. And what we do is, rather than sanding the whole bottom, we leave it there and we carve this amount of material away. So now the airfoil is semi-symmetrical. It unloads the motor more. And what happens is, right now, we probably gain 300 or 400 RPM, but at the same time we're gaining RPM, we're increasing pitch by the amount we carve away. So what happens is we still have, if you can picture how this works, in this prop blade we've lost a lot of material. So it now becomes a thinner prop. In this instance, we haven't lost a whole lot of material, so we still have a relatively thick, very powerful prop, but we've increased the pitch. Now, whether Phillips entry is the right word, I'm not sure. And I'm not in business to try to make this sound overly complicated. But if you have a plane with a wood prop, a Nobler with a 10-6, just doing this will make it a 10-6 and a quarter. Probably on a hot day, this will really be what you want. Same thing here. You have a tuned pipe, a Rojet 77. You want to go from 5-6 to 5-5. That's probably going to be the best way to do it. It's just that little bit of material. Now, typically this would be done to carbon props, but not always. You could flip-flop back and forth here, but I'm just trying to show that the typical things that happen is when you increase the pitch, think of being in a car, you're in first gear, increase the pitch, you're in second gear, increase the pitch, third gear, increase the... You want to find the pitch that matches the speed you want to go. Now, pretend you're in your Windstar, and you're in first gear. The motor's as fast as it'll go, but you're going 30 miles an hour. But you want to go 40. Well, you go up a gear. Now, you really want to go 50. The motor stays the same, you go up one gear. At some point in time, that motor won't turn the gear. Well, now you know what the choices are. You either have to put a bigger motor in, or make the Windstar smaller, or in some way, get an efficiency gain. This is an efficiency gain. You're going to get more power, at the same time you're going to get more speed. Now, you wouldn't want to do this to a plane that's overpowered. And now we get into a very gray area of, first the person has to identify what they want to change. And my analogy is you go into a shoe store. You go into a shoe store, you put on a pair of shoes. There are two choices. There's really three, but for me there's always two. Shoes are too big, shoes are too small. They're almost never just right. And even if they're right, if this is the right shoe, you want to know which one is too big, which one is too small. And that almost, without even using this shoe, you know that if this is a 9 and it's too small, this is an 11, it's too big, the 10 is going to fit. So diagnosing what you want to do and being it, but first, what good is diagnosing something if you can't change it? You've got to be able to change it too. And you want to know how to change it. Okay, here's the dilemma I have as a person that tries to offer technical advice. Frequently asked questions. Most common is, let's make it real simple so we can start this. I have just bought a Cardinal, Brodak Cardinal, and I put in motor, let's make three choices just to make it simple. I put in, and the three probably the most popular choices for that ship would be, I put in a Brodak 40. I put in an LA 46. And I put in a Rojet 40. Now, each one of these is going to be just a little bit different. So what will happen is now some person's bought either an ARF or a kit. They've bought the motor, and now they want to know what prop to buy. Well, just the typical thing that would happen is I would say, here's one of the ways that we do this, is to buy a couple of the very inexpensive wood props. These would be my choices. 10-6, a 10-5, an 11-6, and an 11-5. And these would give you four choices that probably for under $25 you could be out there doing your testing. You can say to yourself, well, with a 10-6, am I going too fast or too slow? A 10-5, too fast or too slow? 11-6, is it loading the motor too much? 11-5, loading the motor not enough? And you can come up with some basic raw data. Now once you have that raw data, then sometimes you might choose to call Wendy, call somebody else that's advising you on this. In this case, Brodak 40 information from Tom Hampshire, Bob Zambelli. People work with that motor constantly. Even though I have one, I have a limited amount of time developing it. But you'd always want to know which one goes too fast and which one too slow. And then you can back down. And it may be that what'll happen is you wind up with an 11-6 cut to 10.5-6 as the perfect choice. Maybe. I don't know. But it's through this process that you arrive at what you hope is going to be the best prop for that plane. Now what's going to determine that is the weight of the plane, the drag, and how you have the motor set up. And I'll put a 2-4 brake or whatever other system you're using. If you set it up with a 2-4 brake, it's a relatively draggy plane. It's got a thick wing, unlike an old-time plane. And if it's where it should be, about 45 ounces, what'll happen is probably all of the props will work, and you could fine-tune based on the next factor we're going to discuss, the weather. But you get really close, what we're going to call a ballpark number. You'll wind up with, at some point in time, a ballpark number. And from that ballpark number, now you could take this prop, fine-tune one with a Phillips entry, cut one to maybe 10.25. Once you know which prop you're going to use, now you can fine-tune it. Maybe you could take some pitch out. So what you're really doing here is you're starting off with a yardstick, then you're narrowing it down to using a ruler, and then you're narrowing it down to using a micrometer. So you're constantly getting it better, cutting in half the difference, cutting in half, and that's how the real tuning of the world happens. It's a rough, get it real rough, get it a little bit closer, check the motor load, get that prop that seems to work the best, and then make one with a Phillips entry, one with a 10 and a quarter, a little less pitch, a little more pitch, make a variety of them. And by doing this, you can always back up on any day and say, well, let me go see if the 11.5 worked better. And always go back and forth between two props, which we always call the square one. The best prop you've developed, you go to a hobby shop, you buy five more props. You try your good prop, immediately take it off, put the other one on. Put it back on, put the next one on. Always go back to the square one so you don't lose where you are. When you lose your square one, it's like hitting a reset button on a calculator. You've got to go back and start all over again. Always to have a square one. Now, in the case of an LA46 is something we know a lot about because, we've sold a lot of them. And almost everybody has come up with an 11.5 zinger as the prop, just to make this real easy. Now, if you want to spend money on carbon props, Doran makes good ones, Randy Smith, Brian Ether, among other people. But you're going to get 90% of what you want with that LA46, and not a 40 now, a 46. You're going to get it from that 11.5 zinger. But now from this 11.5, why not make one? This would be what I would do. 10 and 3 quarters, same. And then up, what I call an up pitch one, a Phillips entry one, and a down pitch one. Well, now you've got from common denominator information, and this is from many, many people I've seen flying this plane with this engine, they settle on this real quick. Then they go and start chopping and Phillips entrying and they fine tune it. Well, it isn't long and it isn't expensive before they come up with, and Danny Banjock has done this, Bob Zambelli, you can't even, there's just 100 people that have had no problem doing that. Now, the Rojet 40 that I have, now we've got an engine that I have a lot of experience with because I've got it in my twin engine planes. What I found works real well on the Rojet 40 is they're called Gator props. They're made by Doran. And I've started off with a 3-blade. And if you go back over my subscriber videos, I have all of these tests, hundreds and hundreds of tests on video. But you get to see that what I did is I constantly went back because Gator props are unique. They have a constant pitch, not a helical pitch. So the Gator props are very similar. The extra blade just increases the load. So I would wind up with my 3-blade at maybe 11 and a quarter. My 2-blade maybe 11 and 3 quarters. For the same prop load, I'd get the same RPM, the same prop load. And then I'd have a variety of things that I could do to these props, take the pitch out, put the pitch in, and vary them and fine-tune. And I have had a lot of luck fine-tuning Rojet 40 props to where I've even had it working well. I thought it was pretty good on my twins. And all the twins interchange motors and props. So I'm able to go right from the Tiger Cat to the A26, A26 to the B25. The A26 is not with us anymore, so we'll get that out of the equation. But what I'm guessing at is that I could also do this, and I have done it with 11.5 zingers. I've started with 11.5s. They seem a little pitchy. I've taken a little bit of the pitch out. And here's what's happened. I've gotten close to Gator performance with wood props. Now, you may want to have a 3-bladed prop for the look of a plane. You may want to have a 2-blade for some other reason. But what happens is, whether you fine-tune the 11.5 zinger or fine-tune the Gator, it's the tuning that's going to give you the performance, not the original part. None of these parts are going to be optimized right off the shelf. Only in the rarest condition do you take a prop right off the shelf and it works perfectly. That's like going to a shoe store. You try on a size 10 sneaker, if it's perfect, you walk out of the store. Yeah, it happens, not that often. Now, these are some of the things that make prop testing, in my case, I enjoy it, but a lot of people get frustrated. You always wind up with what I call hard choices. Now, you may have this prop, we don't even have to identify it, but you've worked on it, this is your square one prop, and You've got this other prop that you've done a little bit of work on, and you've got, there's a hard choice now going to come up, is what happens, this prop flies the plane the best. You like flying at whatever ship it is with that prop. But there's a problem. It overloads the motor. You've got to do several, you've got several choices now. On one side of this equation, even though this is the best prop, it may be a little bigger diameter than what your motor will turn. So some of the choices would be, is, and let me just kind of make a list, a short list of, you could put less diameter. If this is, if it's flying the plane great, but the motor isn't too far in the way it should, it isn't increasing RPM when you pick the nose up, it's sagging, just a tad less diameter. You can also take a tad less pitch. See, pitch will get rid of it too. You can also thin the blades. You can also, if you have an under camber, you can take under camber out. So this is one way of approaching this kind of a let's call it a dilemma. Just some of the things you can do. That's the direction you would want to go in. But you still want to fly that prop. Well, there's another choice. In this case, let's pretend that you had a PA-51 in the plane, which I've done this for several people over the years. Mike Cooper, Rich Peabody, among people that had PA-51s, and they had a prop that they really like. Well, they just upgrade the motor to a 61. Problem solved. Now you've got the best of both worlds. You've got the prop you really want to fly, the bigger motor. I've also seen the same thing happen to me as I had, and this is just going to be a real funny thing, and I remember doing this on video. I had my GMA, George Aldrich, 60 jet in the Spitfire. Did this, in fact, in the last year or two. And that would turn, at best, maybe about a 12.5-inch prop. Well, what happened when I got the RoJet? The RoJet 61, wow, that would go right to a 13-inch prop. Same props now, same props. I just got an increase in diameter. At the same time, a tremendous increase in performance. Then I got to the RoJet, the 65 I had, and I found out you could go right to 13.5 on the diameter with no problem at all. And that just made me crazy waiting to get the RoJet 77, which is in the plane now. And any of the subscribers know that that turns a full 14-inch prop. So what happens is, every time you increase the size of the motor, you increase the diameter you can turn, you almost always increase performance. Now there's downsides to this. This is one way of doing things. You also have a lot of people that their trim technique is different. And what they do is they'll set up a nobler, like a Thunderbird, doesn't matter. It can be any plane. And what they find is that because of the way the plane is designed or the way it's built or what it weighs, that a smaller prop works better. The reason usually is if the plane is light, or if they're looking to correct for what we'll call GP, and I'll leave that to Al Raby to define for you how the spiral air goes around the body. Too long of a discussion now. But some of the downsides of big props, on a real light plane or a plane without a Raby rudder, everybody knows what that is, I'm sure, what can happen with big props is you can wind up with wiggles and yaws and different things. I've never found any of that to be a problem as long as I have a Raby rudder. Now, a light plane with a big prop tends to get wiggly, I found. So what happens is somebody, or a plane with a poor corner. Planes with aerodynamics that don't really, non-modern aerodynamics, where they're looking for more corner, one of the quick ways to get more corner is just make the prop smaller. So you trade away a little tension, drive, whatever, but a smaller prop will give you more corner. But there's certain other situations. If you have a plane that's really overpowered, now a lot of people, remember, go back to our chart, a lot of people built planes that were made for 51s, and right now they have 77s in them. They have 60-ounce planes with 77s. Well, what can happen with a big, powerful prop? They can just get totally overpowered to where that power is hard to control. Thankfully, if they've gotten to that point, they know about reducing power through exhaust system tuning and Venturi size, or in Rich Oliver's case, nylon stockings over the Venturis, or head gaskets in my case. There's a lot of ways to detune it, but if you build a plane, I mean, and just think about it, if you build a skateboard or a go-kart and you have a Chrysler Hemi with a supercharger, you just touch the gas and that's going to go. Well, that isn't any good on a wingover pullout, especially if it's inconsistent. So, certain choices, and they may be in the minority where you want a smaller diameter prop, or if you're flying in runway air, this is really probably a good setup. But every place else in the world where the air is rough, where it's bumpy, where the trees are around, I've never found a reason that I didn't want the prop to be as big as possible, and then I retrim the plane, move the CG back accordingly, get the Raby rudder adjusted. And I've never not been able to get rid of all of that, what in the past when planes used to be built, well, some people still build them without an adjustable rudder. You certainly can build yourself into a box where you've got to trade off one for the other. But the best combination I know of is big engine, big prop, Raby rudder. That's what's always worked well for me. Now, no matter what prop you have, in this case it's a three-blade carbon fiber prop, but it doesn't matter. No matter what prop it is, it's going to have a pitch. The pitch is going to be defined as, and let me just make a drawing. You can look at any prop and pretty much see the pitch. Now, if you look at this being the hub, and this is a flat plane. I would call this the datum line. That might not be the right nomenclature, but that's okay. This hub is going to be parallel to this, the bottom of the hub. And the prop pitch, unless it's a zero pitch prop, is going to be canted up from that by an amount. Now that amount you can measure in a lot of different ways. I make up a little gauge, and what I have is a little angle, and you can see how many times I've changed it. Because all I care about, and this is my own personal way of doing it, it's a way that works for me. There are other ways, there are other people that feel differently, and rather than contradicting each other, just try their way, try my way, figure it out what's going to work for you. Same way as going in a shoe store and see what shoe fits for you. Well, if I take this prop, doesn't matter what prop, I only want to go, in fact this prop's too small, I can't do it. I have to get a bigger prop. Okay, I want to look down this edge, and I'm not sure you can, but you can see the light. So this prop has more pitch than I want. You see the leading edge is up. Now what I want to wind up with is that the leading edge and trailing edge are touching at the same time. So, and I'm not going to do this on camera because this really starts to take time. You can spend 2 or 3 hours on one prop. I want to take this blade, get boiling water where there are bubbles in the water. This, all props are made out of a resin. Most of them are made out of EPON 862. It softens at 165 degrees. So boiling water, by putting this in boiling water, count to 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Take it out and just very carefully now, just don't grab it and make a pretzel out of it. You want to do it with your bare hands, and I like to use an oven mitt, and I've got this on a whole lot of the subscriber videos. I don't want to just redundantly repeat things, but what I want to do is I really only care about the pitch, this last inch of pitch, but this last inch of pitch had better be micrometer accurate. So what I do is when I have my gauge, now let me make this, this might be let's see, we have a datum line. I want to try to make this as simple as possible. You can bolt your prop hub up. Just put a nut and a bolt, some quarter 28 rod with a nut on one end is the way I've done it. And you can see how that's just to see. So you have a stud, but really. When you put the prop, this is the hub. When you put the prop up and the blade is going to be on this angle, let's make it the angle we know. Now I take a piece of plywood and just glue it flat so I have that angle.
Now what happens is, see, if you look down the bolt, I know exactly what pitch I had when I started, and every time I change it, I increase or decrease the pitch, but that allows me to get either the 3, 2, 3, or in this case, this is for a Rojet 65, but I have a whole box of these gauges. Very inexpensive, a piece of motor mount. Each one leaves an inch of prop sticking out. And I'm able to get this that both sides of this prop, and I'm going to use a big prop here just to make an example. I got a 16-inch prop from my 91. Let me just show how, if we were to do this, this would increase the pitch. And I mean, just seeing light under there is enough to change the speed and model. That probably right there is going from, if we were going 5.5, right now it's 5.3, 5.2, 5.1. The opposite, if that's going 4.8, 5.0, just, you can use a piece of, I used to use a piece of 64th plywood. But all I care about, in essence, is this last inch of pitch. This last inch. This is doing 99% of the work. Now a lot of people, Rich Oliver for one, they pitch all the stations. Now a lot of people find that useful. I haven't found it to be real useful. They pitch every station like you do on a Prather gauge. Because each one of these, if I was going to make a, and I don't know what the number would be, some of the aerodynamic people, probably Dave Downey would know right off the top of his head. What really happens is this last inch of pitch, this is going to account for about 92 or 95, I've heard both, 92 and 95% of the drive that you get. Because it's in the biggest arc. It travels the furthest. So it does an awful lot of work. If you picture what that last inch is doing, it's doing a lot of work. Now, as you move inward, this station here is doing a lot less work. And this is why most props, except for gator props, most props have what's called helical pitch. This station here, by the time you get halfway through the prop, this is going along for a ride. And the stuff that's under the spinner, let's face it, isn't doing anything at all. So if you understand, and if you can pretty much use to your advantage the fact that it's this area here that you've got to get right. This is the one that really, really matters. If the rest aren't exactly right, nothing bad's going to really happen. But if this one's wrong, or if I change this radically, this is going to change the whole thing. This is going to go from being a weak prop to a prop that's way too strong. If I change the pitch, if I change the thickness, or if I change the aspect ratio. And in some cases, and I've done this already, I've done this on a Spitfire, I've made rake tip props, I've made square tip props. I think for our purposes, square tip props seem to work just as well as anything, except when the engine is being overloaded and you want to keep every bit of diameter, and then a little bit of a rake tip, making it like a flight streak wing or a Miss Ashley tip, seems to have lets the motor unload a little more. But it's still this last inch that matters. And if you know that it's this last inch that matters, you are way ahead of the poor guy that's spending his life pitching this station. And in this case, you can make this pitched up. You can also thin it in this dimension just a little bit. And you can take and just bring this more to a point, a very little at a time. Now, on helical pitch props, bollies are helical pitch, means they have a lot of pitch here. This is probably a couple numbers bigger than it gets out at the tip. It kind of flattens out. Well, that does a lot of things. A gator prop is a unique prop. It has the same pitch at every station. And there's really no reason to even bother with these that I've found. Because if I get this station right, what happens, these stations, in essence, are working very inefficiently. But by these stations working inefficiently, I have a much lower drag from this part of the prop, and it lets me make a lot more power out at the tip.
So it's a trick. It's like having a baseball bat that's very thin at the handle and then gets real big out at the tip where you're going to hit the ball. Well, helical pitch props put a lot of load in the motor down here where they're not doing anything, and it compromises how much power you can squeeze out of the tip or how much diameter you can use. I found Doran's props to be very efficient, but like any prop, they need to be fine-tuned to your plane's weight, the power that's available, the weather. We haven't even touched on the weather yet. What are some of the other factors that are going to make this setup work for you? Let's just touch on one other subject here. And this may be something a lot of people already know. You can define it however you want. Some people define it as density altitude. What you want to have a knowledge of is the three H's: hot, high, and humid. If you're a pilot, I'm sure you're already well versed in this, as I was when I was drilled in school flying my air coupe trying to figure out what the implications of hot, high, and humid are. Each one of these deteriorates performance. Hot, high, and humid. It deteriorates performance in a lot of different ways. It deteriorates, well, first off, the motor's performance. The motor makes less power. The prop gets less efficient. The wing gets less efficient. These are all negative things. These things all go down under hot, high, and humid. So the first thing to be aware of always is you do not want to have one setup for any given airplane or any given, especially a competition thing where you're looking to win contests. You want to have, let's call it a setup for the density altitude when it's either hot, high, or humid, or some combination of these. It's the combination, any combination, that makes for less performance.